Good evening. Welcome once again to Camp Corona, bitch. Tonight, it's the end of week one. Just about the end of week one. I'm going to let everybody file in so we can get started. We have a few things to discuss. If you can in the comments, just leave, how have you been coping? I've been talking to some of you guys on social media about coping with Corona. I have not been able to get my head shaved. I have to do it myself these days, so I will be wearing an assortment of head pieces. I'm actually doing an experiment, guys. I want to actually grow my hair for as long as I can see where it goes. In regards to that, but how's everybody dealing? Hey, what's going on, Doris, my love? Kelly, Tula's here. Brick City in the house. Ow, hey, Jaina, Erica. So, I want to discuss while everybody's fouling in, everything that's been going on this week. So, shit is starting to get real, peeps. It's starting to get real, bitch. And I think that some people saw this coming, some people didn't. Hey, Candace, I think that, the reality is starting to set in, especially for young people, because I'm noticing, at least in the United States, we're starting to get a lot of cases of young people. It's not necessarily the old folks. The old folks, it seems like, are heeding the warning and starting to stay in the house. It's a lot of young people that want to go play basketball. They're out on the beach. They're going to parties. They're having wine. They're doing basically every dumb fucking thing we tell people not to do in a disaster movie. Like, we're literally living in a disaster movie, bitch. Like, literally, what happens in a disaster movie? One incident happens in some far-off place, because, you know, they always take, the movie always take place in the United States with global shit that's going on. So, something happens in some far-ass place. We pay it, but the scientists and the doctors don't pay it. They say, hey, knock, knock, bitch, something's going down. Knock, knock, bitch, pay attention. The government pay it. We move on with our lives. Wham, bam, Chappelle, whole outbreak outside of the fucking country. Now the government panicking, trying to scramble, still not listening to the scientists. Our dumbasses in the movie, we going around doing the same nut-ass shit we've been doing, not following instructions. Wham, bam, Chappelle, fast forward, you're locked down in the house, martial law, and it's contagion, bitch. If I see one more motherfucker on a basketball court, one more motherfucker, they had to close the malls here in Maryland. I don't think they got the hint. Like, I don't think they did. And I think what it's going to take, like, and my heart goes out to that family in New Jersey. I don't know if you guys saw it online, a family in New Jersey where I believe about three or four of the family members in one family died from coronavirus. And I just think that's terrible. And my heart goes out to them. In regards to that, I have a friend that possibly has it or had it, exhibited a lot of symptoms. So, you know, I'm taking this very seriously. I think a lot of people are taking it seriously, but it's still, as Americans don't really believe shit until it's like right at their doorstep. Like, it's gotta be in their face, bitch. And I think that that's, yes, contagion tease, MJ, contagion tease. I think that's what it has to come down to. Now, with that being said, I feel like we're living in a time of worst case scenario across the board. Worst case scenario, having a virus happen in the year 2020 like this. Worst case scenario of the Olympics being canceled, all of these events being canceled. Worst case scenario, and I think the Olympics are canceled. Don't quote me. I'm going to double check that. Let me check that while I have my computer here. But I believe they're canceled. Worst case scenario, the president we got, bitch. of all time. Like, don't you miss Barack? I would even prefer George motherfucking Bush, bitch. Either one. Either Bush. I would take either Bush in this situation. That's how shit is. I would take Reagan. And I was a damn sperm in my daddy's sack when Reagan was the president. I would take anybody but Trump at this point. I think this is the worst person to have sitting in the seat of the president of the United States at a time like this. Bad information, wrong information, just outright lies. You lied on Google last week. Now the doctors got to step up, poor things, and say, hey guys, that vaccine that we're testing and rolling out that he says is going to be available next week, this shit is still in trials, like, for 12 months. Sorry. Like, the absolute worst. Not having the proper provisions, things of that nature. The hospitals are running out of masks. They're running out of supplies. Like, New York City, the mayor of New York was on the news last night, and he basically was saying that they're good through March, but like 2 to 3 weeks, they're going to be running low. You have medical professionals having to reuse masks, use bandanas. This is the United States of America. Meanwhile, over in China, they have helmets on their police that can detect your temperature. When you come in to the country, you get a QR code, one of those little codes you scan to get free shit or to find, you know, information out. You get one of those, and from the QR code, they can tell, because they use tracking, like there's cameras everywhere, they track it, so they can tell if you've been in contact with somebody with the coronavirus, what's your likelihood of contracting, if you need the quarantine, or if it's a mandatory quarantine. China, they made, you know, whatever you want to call it, they definitely, I don't understand how you can still say the United States is the number one country in the world from a technology perspective. Maybe from a war perspective, maybe from a dominance perspective, possibly. But from a technology perspective, we are so behind. So behind. Somebody left a comment, I forget who it was, I apologize, in one of my posts, and he said, the United States operates off of 1950s infrastructure and 1920s capitalism. And I couldn't agree more. I think we're severely outdated. And when you have bad leadership, that contributes to even more chaos. Now, one thing I am going to say, bitch, motherfucking Andrew Cuomo, bitch, governor of New York, bitch, he might as well be the president right now. I don't know about you, but bitch, when it comes to me, I don't even pay attention to Trump's briefs. I read the cliff notes after his ass is gone. But when Cuomo come on, I'm front and center every goddamn day. I feel like, low-key, unofficially, he's become that common voice and that voice of reason and that voice that Americans are trusting in this crisis. Okay? I will say this across the board, in my opinion. I don't know what's going on in each and every individual state, but I know in my state, Governor Hogan, I ain't vote for your ass. Now, I ain't gonna lie, I did vote for him the second time. But the first time I didn't vote for his ass, I'm a staunch Democrat. Hogan is a Republican, but he's been doing a great job as the governor here, in my opinion. No, he's not perfect, but I gotta say, he's a Marylander, or he's representing Maryland, and he act like he got fucking sense. I think Governor Hogan has been doing a spectacular job, because I believe in giving people their roses when they do good and roasting their ass when they fuck up. So at the end of the day, I'm not going to say that he has not been doing his job. I think he's done an excellent job. He has not been playing, and I'm very proud and happy to have him sitting in that chair keeping some kind of order and keeping shit together. And that's the bottom line. You can say what you want about the man, about, you know, certain issues and things like that. But I posted this last night on my Facebook. In times of a political crisis, well, in times of a public crisis, in politics, this determines who's a hero and who's a villain. It's no in between. No, it's no, okay. And you know when I learned that lesson? I learned that lesson in the uprising when we had Freddie Gray. And it was a commotion in the city for a couple of days. And that really determined how Stephanie Rawlins Blake, who was the mayor at that time in Baltimore, would be remembered. So these are the times that really make your careers. Like, no shade, I don't know if he's considering it, but Andrew Cuomo, bitch, if you want to run for president in 2024, you're making a good case for it. As long as you don't do no fuck shit or no nut ass shit between now and 2024, he could do it. And people do forget the good things you do, but with the crises like this, especially with the general public and good PR, he could run for president. Hogan, if he decides to take that next step, could possibly do that as well. But Cuomo, he got the country by the balls, man, because he's doing everything you're supposed to do. Even if you hate the man, because in New York, it's kind of touch and go, the citizens of New York, from what I'm understanding from my friends who live there and people who are there. They they touch and go with him. But I must say, in this time, he has done, from a public relations standpoint, I think Andrew Cuomo, even going on CNN and talking to his brother at night, giving the updates, like, all that shit matters. This is fucking show business. Even though we're in a crisis, it's all show business. All of it. Those meetings are show business. Those briefings are show business. Him going on CNN is show business. All of it is show business. The problem is Trump, who actually is in show business, is not doing good with show business right now. That's the bottom line. He's ill-equipped. He's unprepared. This is what you voted. You voted for a businessman. America is a business. And guess what? He can't run it. So if your claim for voting for him was that, this is kind of putting a hole in that theory. Okay? Just found out Andy Cohen. If you watch any of the Real Housewives shows or Bravo, sending love out to him. He has been tested positive for coronavirus. And I believe they're saying his child as well, his baby. So, you know, people are catching it. Now, there is this thing where folks are saying, well, all of the celebrities are getting their tests. And that's true. Here's my thing. This is still America. This is still America. Beauty is a currency. Celebrity is a currency. Power is a currency. So it wouldn't be lost on me that if you're in the NBA or you run a successful television network, that you will get a test first. That's not far-fetched. I mean, let's not forget the country that we live in. My issue is not having enough tests. I'm from Baltimore, of course. I say it all the time, and we have Johns Hopkins. So kudos to Johns Hopkins for creating their own coronavirus testing system and actively working on a cure and treatments to possibly subside this thing. Shout out to Johns Hopkins, Baltimore-based, Baltimore City. That's the one thing I will say about living in the state of Maryland, at least in the Baltimore, you know, greater Baltimore area, is we have some of the best medical institutions. I know we personally talk shit about them here, but if my life was in somebody's hands, I would want it to be in university. Johns Hopkins. GBMC, possibly. St. Joe's. Like, I want a Maryland hospital. That's just facts. We have some of the best healthcare in the world. Kids and parents from all around the world send their kids here to go to Johns Hopkins University for medicine and science. So that's just facts. I mean, you don't have to like them, but that's just facts. Bitch, I definitely don't want to be in Los Angeles at Cedar Sinai because it seems like every motherfucking famous person dies there and I just can't do it. Okay? That's just me. But speaking of Los Angeles, I was speaking to my friend Eric and my friend Ed, who live in Los Angeles, and proper, they live in LA, and, you know, all of California is locked down. They're locked down pretty much all the whole state, which I don't blame them, because the people in San Francisco, they out walking their dogs, they holding hands, walking down the street, like shit is not real. So guess what? They said, y'all want to play games? We locking all this shit down. And it was interesting hearing their perspective, because think about it, guys. We were watching the news last night. You saw how Times Square was damn near empty, which as a person that goes to New York pretty much probably about 3 times a month back and forth. That's strange. I've never personally seen that. To hear stories of Los Angeles, the Sunset Strip, empty. You know, downtown LA, a ghost town. Like, these are things, like, this is real. And I'm going to say something here. This is a little social commentary, if you'll go down the rabbit hole with me. As a child who was born in the 80s, I was born in the 80s. Oh, my computer almost fell. I was born in the 80s. As a child that was born in the 80s, we, being born in the crack era, but being raised in the 90s, and coming into your teenage years in the early 2000s, shit was kind of cute. No, it wasn't cute for everybody, but overall, shit was kind of cute. You could get you a little summer job. You know, the biggest thing you had to worry about was MTV, TRL, Aaliyah dying, shit like that. You know what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't like, this is shit that when I was growing up, we watched on Independence Day or The Day After Tomorrow or what's the asteroid movie with fucking Ben Affleck and Steven Tyler or Nev Tyler, whatever the hell her name is. Shit like that, Armageddon. This is stuff we watched on TV. It wasn't real to us. It was a worst case scenario. It was a disaster movie. We watch it, we say, oh my God, and we go home, or we turn the channel, we go outside and play. I never thought in a million years that as an adult, after having all of those things as children and teenagers, TRL, 106 in Park, things like that, I never thought as an adult I would be living in a world like this. And when I say living in a world like this, where the housing market is crashing or has crashed, the 2008 crash, you know, or having so much student debt, people coming out of college not being able to get jobs or having to work jobs that have nothing to do with what they went to school with, not even paying them what their degree is actually worth, so that they can't even pay back the loan that they got. I never thought we would be living in a world where there's biological warfare like this going on. No, yes, I did say that. And we would be living in a world where a reality TV star was our president, who didn't know what he was doing, National Guard trucks showing up, riots. Like, these are things that I would have never thought I would live through. And it's so crazy because the other night this week, I watched Children of Men. If you've never seen Children of Men, I highly recommend you see that film. It is one of my favorite films ever. And it's basically a story about how the world basically gets like this, but it's that worst case scenario. London is one of the only countries left kind of intact and still standing. There's this kind of like birth issues, so new babies aren't being born, humanity is dying off, it's a whole thing. And I just, like, watching some of these films, like, it's the country, the world is so overpopulated, they sell suicide kits in, like, CVS or, like, Walgreens and shit like that. Like, this is in the film. And the, around the time it takes place, my generation would be, like, in their, like, 50s, I think, somewhere around there, 40s or 50s. And it's, like, looking at where we are now and how things are headed, that doesn't even seem far-fetched, you know? Like, it is scary. It is very scary. And to I watch these films now with a totally different lens. I watch them very aware. I watch them sometimes to learn, even though it is a film. I watch sometimes to learn because Hollywood has a way of dictating certain things in culture, which is interesting. But I say that to say this. It's a new reality. We will have a new normal. And even thinking about some of the things while we're locked inside. You know, we're locked inside our homes, you know, in our apartment buildings, you know, and I'm going to be honest, wives are locked in with their husbands. They've probably been cheating on them or vice versa. Locked in with husbands or wives that may be beating on them. And they have nowhere else to go in this situation. You can't escape to work. You can't escape to aftercare. You know? Being locked in with your badass kids. Like, now you have to face the reality, bitch, that your kids is bad. And that could be a tough pill to swallow. Because when you actually have to stay home and constantly tell your kids, sit the hell down, after you done cussed out the teacher and sent notes and showed up on PTA night, swearing up and down that the teacher just don't like your child, and now you gotta stay home with that motherfucker and actually watch and see what's going on, bitch. It's gotta hurt. It's gotta hurt. Then y'all, you and your husband or you and your wife gotta sit and have that tough-ass conversation, you know, and talk about Shirley. Hi, Barbara. This Shirley. Or Barbara, the side chick, she climbing up the walls right now. Ain't nothing coming to the house. Ain't no rendezvous and no hotel, bitch. You can't go. They closed. Okay? Can't go. You locked in. I mean, I think this lockdown is going to do a lot for a lot of people. I know me personally, I'm locked down. It's just me and the fucking cat. I mean, me and the cat. You know, I got y'all. I talk to y'all via social media. I'm already, you know, getting tired of this shit. And this is just the end of week one. I am really interested to see how this is going to go. But ultimately, we will survive. We will move on. I have a cabinet full of alcohol. So, you know, we'll survive. But it's definitely time to just sit and reflect, work on projects. And I love this productive movement that's going on. Everybody's being productive. Now, keep in mind, this is week one, bitch. I can't wait to see what week three look like. Week one, everybody, yeah, bitch, I'm at home working. We're going to do this podcast. You know, I got beats. We're going to do this. I'm going to clean up this. I'm going to start this business. Everybody going to start a business while they home. To that cabin fever setting, bitch. Now you're looking crazy. This is week one, bitch. Week one is like the first day of school. Everybody do their homework first day of school, bitch. I want to see what you look like week three and week four. Oh, because there's going to be a week three and a week four. Okay. I do encourage you to support artists, to support your friends who are waiters or servers or drivers who don't have that good work at home option, or, you know, can't file for unemployment because the job playing technical games. I saw online somebody posted that their family member worked for the Marriott. Marriott basically laid everybody off. And then the employee goes to file for unemployment. When unemployment called a Marriott, the Marriott say he's not laid off. He's on a 0-hour schedule. Bitch, what the fuck that mean? 0 hours is no work, bitch. I'm mad at the unemployment office for not approving this shit. I'm not even mad at the Marriott. Because if I tell you some shit, it's 0 hours, bitch. And you say, oh, but you still employed. Like, what the fuck that mean? Unemployment ain't got no motherfucking sense. Y'all don't know what's going on? I think that's crazy. And also, too, some businesses, because they are small, they are local, they just can't afford to pay their employees in some cases because they just don't have it. For those mom and pop businesses and things like that. But for these big corporations, this should be nothing. Because here's why it should be nothing. While Trump has been in office, he's given big business a lot of tax breaks. All that money that you got from tax breaks, bitch, this is where you take it and pay it forward. Even if you pay people an average of what their hours are. Or something. Because we don't know how long this is going to last. Trump talking about we're going to be getting checks. We'll see. We'll see. I think that right now everything is so early. And like I said, it's essentially for most of America, week one. So in week one, it's kind of hard. Everybody has great intentions. Like I said, week one is the first day of school. Everybody gonna get 90s. Everybody gonna go to coach class. Everybody gonna come in on time. We'll revisit this in week three and week four. And see what happens. Now, I will say this. There is a lot of great TV. I was looking online and Universal has released some of their films that are in theaters or were in theaters at the time when the movie theaters started closing. And you can now rent them to stream for 48 hours in your home, which I think is fucking marvelous, especially for somebody like me who practically lives at the movies because I ain't got no man. This is great for me. I'm all about it. You know, a movie rental situation. So that's another good thing. Also, too, I am formally going to try this Netflix party thing. And I want to try it with Madam CJ Walker. What I'm going to do, for those of you who are watching this video on YouTube, for those of you who are watching this preview on Instagram, for those of you who are watching this on Facebook Live as we speak, I will post the Netflix party link and you can go ahead and log in. Now, with that being said, they have an option where you can control who stops, start, and pause the movie. Bitch, ain't nobody getting a remote but me. I'm just saying. Me. Okay. We're going to do Madam CJ Walker. We're going to do the first two parts Saturday night at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Once again, watch Madam CJ Walker with me Saturday, tomorrow, 8 p.m. Standard Eastern Time. Eastern Standard Time. I will be putting out the link prior to around in the 7 o'clock hour, 7:30. So everybody has it so we can watch together, chat online. And of course, you know, I'll be giving my commentary, via my Facebook page as well. I'm also looking into some other options to do, during the week. Oh, bitch, it's a whole DDM programming, bitch, going on, okay? The DDM network. Also, on Monday, I have a album that I did that was never released for whatever reason called Soundtrack to a Shopping Mall. I'm going to be having that available to stream on a secured website, free of charge, for 48 hours. You'll be able to view the music videos from that album that were never released, listen to it in its entirety, as well as view the behind-the-scenes documentary and the album artwork. And yes, I do think you need a Netflix login to do Netflix Party. I can't give you everything, but yeah, you will need a Netflix login to do the Netflix Party, I believe. So if you've been using your cousin Netflix, you might want to sign up at this point, or at least get the free trial, bitch. I don't know what to tell you. But you will need to do that as well. But quarantine has been interesting. Like I said, I'm going to be growing my hair for as long as we're locked down. How come? I feel like Jay-Z, because the barbers are closing, the nail shops are closing, and this is going to be interesting. This is where you're going to find out who was dependent on weaves and who was really about that life. Because once you can't get your sewing, bitch, we're going to find out how big you are. Are you this big? Are you this big? Some of y'all is this big, and hey, you do what you got to do. I hope y'all got a lace front or a wig somewhere in your home so that you can go ahead and do what you need to do. But tomorrow we will be watching Madam C.J. Walker. If you need updates, corona updates, because I do special things on my Instagram and on my TikTok, you can follow me on either one of those platforms at Dapper, D-A-P-P-E-R, Dan, D-A-N, Midas. That's at Dapper Dan Midas. That's what DDM stands for. But yeah, we've got a lot to do, a lot to discuss. Oh, bitch. Okay, before we get out of here. Andrew Gillum, bitch. Now, I did a whole special damn near on Andrew Gillum. But recently, the Daily Mail, because the UK press, they savage. I shared it from Love B. Scott, but the UK press is where it originated. So they got the photos from, and here's the thing. I'm going to speak on this a little bit, and then we're going to go, because I have to cook, and yeah. With Andrew Gillum, when the pictures leaked, I hate, not to say that I'm right, but I hate my assumption being right. And I think a lot of gay folks, especially gay black folks, kind of knew what was going on. That once we read what happened, we could already put the story together. And when you see the photos that were leaked, I hate being right. I hated being right about that. I really do. I hated being right about that. I do have some questions, though. First off, who took the pictures, bitch? Because there was a foot. If you look at one of the pictures, and there was a foot in one of the photos where it looked like, I don't know if it was the man that called the police before he attempted CPR or after, whatever he said he did. But there's a foot in the photo that looks like it's a foot with no shoe on it. That looks like the person that took the picture. I don't think these pictures are police pictures. I don't think the police came in and snapped pictures. I could be wrong, but I strongly don't believe that. I think, and somebody put this up in the comments, and I agree, I think the man, the good Samaritan, the man, the other friend, I think he took pictures. The pictures, here's what I think happened. The one that performed the CPR and called the police took the pictures, not knowing if the story was actually going to make the news. What was going to happen is, and this is purely DDM conspiracy theory speculation, what was going to happen was, if the shit didn't make the news, he was going to send the pictures to Andrew Gillum and blackmail him for money. But by the shit hitting the news, because the police, of course, came, the shit ran, you can't blackmail nobody for pictures. And even if he did try to blackmail Andrew Gillum for pictures, the damage is already done. The wife done already put the story together. It's already over the news. So really, those pictures, yeah, they add more embarrassment. But if you're trying to get money out of somebody, it's really not much you can get. I think those pictures were taken for future blackmailing. And by coming out, they weren't useless. So he sold down to the highest bidder from the press, which the British press loves a moment like that. They just do. And we're talking about Andrew Gillum, for those of you just joining. And that's how we got those photos. I swear, bitch, I could give Jessica Fletcher a run for her money. I'm just saying. That's just how I feel. Okay? But it is unfortunate that things have panned out this way for him. Because the thing is, I want to be very clear. These type of things happen with politicians all the time. Like, it's plenty of gay politicians, you know, Lindsey Graham, who walk around acting straight or act like, you know, even if they straight and they just do scandalous shit. There's plenty of politicians that do scandalous shit. Exhibit A, them GOP senators or congressmen who dumped their stocks this morning. Read about that. Politicians have been doing scandalous shit for years. I think the thing is, once again, when you play the hero, you have to be careful. You have to really watch it. You have to really know the company that you're keeping. I don't know if the room was in Andrew's name or not. I have to research that. But I feel like, Andrew, if you was going, you know, you want to get your rocks off, I understand, I get it. But here's what you should have did. This is what I would have did. Number one, the rum wouldn't have been in my name. The rum would have been in the prostitute name. Okay? That's what I would have did. Second thing, it would have been me and the prostitute. It wouldn't have been nobody else. Don't call your friend. It ain't no third parties, not unless y'all into that type of thing. But it would have just been me and the prostitute. I'd have been very clear. Don't bring nobody else to this room. Don't tell nobody where you're going. Okay? It was just supposed to be you and him. Not you, him, the friend, and all of that. Especially if you're doing some shit you ain't supposed to be doing. Third thing. I would have never let myself get that incapacitated to the point where I don't have control over the situation. But once again, if you watch my video on Andrew Gillum and we talked about Tina and all of that, he probably was so fucking drunk and high out of his goddamn mind. The prostitute was obviously high on drugs that he couldn't control it. You wasn't supposed to get that drunk, Andrew. Not when you're doing shit that you're not supposed to be doing. You were supposed to go in there, excuse my French, bust your nut, give him his money, tell his ass to leave, and take your ass to bed. Now you caught in the room. I'm surprised that they haven't pressed any type of criminal charges. You caught in the room with meth bags. They got close-up pictures of the meth bags. That's why I know the friend set your ass up or the friend was going to blackmail you. Because if you come into a room, here's the thing. And this is why you gotta watch the company you keep, America, Cabinet. If you see come in somebody's room and you see them passed out, incapacitated, naked, vomiting on the floor, which this man has probably saw that a lot of times in the line of work that he's in because he could have been the pimp for that prostitute. You and me, we were going to be like, oh my God, get him! Immediately CPR, we ain't think about cam for nothing. Oh my God! That's what we gonna do. somebody who's used to seeing that and is a seasoned professional, he gonna gather all of the shit. Now, the person that did this was very calculating and very calm and very used to it. You go in there and you take pictures first, then you do the life-saving measures and call the police. Let's get into the psychology of the person that took the pictures. I wish them the best. Maybe you can write a book. Especially with where the Democratic Party is right now, they're going to dump him. They don't want the Democratic Party. They don't want no parts of this shit. He is done. He could be a Republican now, if he want to go that route. But he's done. The done done. What Nicki Minaj say? The done done. He's done. But I'm gonna let you guys go for this evening. Don't forget tomorrow, Madam C.J. Walker Netflix party, 8 p.m. with yours truly. Monday, Soundtrack to a Shopping Mall will be available for 48 hours to stream. Don't forget to follow me on social media, on Instagram, TikTok, and Twitter at Dapper Dan Midas. Subscribe to YouTube, Secretary of Shade, and don't forget to hit the bell at the top for notifications. You guys have a great Friday in the house. Enjoy your weekend in the house. And y'all be safe. I love y'all.